So morning, everyone. I think it's been a great morning. We had some great session from Ron earlier in the morning. Sumit shared some great stuff about the perspective from design. I'm just going to take the discussion to the next level, which is, and I'm sure many of you probably have, as practitioners, come across these two sexiest words of LinkedIn: design thinking and lean startup. Anyone who has not heard either of them? Okay, you are in the right room then. And we keep hearing about design thinking and lean startup and bunch of stuff there, and there's always this kind of a thing, and people throw that indiscriminately. Hey, why don't you try with design thinking? Or we are using lean startup. And then there are some people who say we do both of them. It's like, what does it even mean actually? How do you really decide whether one is better than other and one is suitable than other in a given context there? So these are some of the thoughts that I thought, why not we discuss some of them. Are they really friends? Do they really go on together, hand in hand? Or they are foes? They really are orthogonal to each other. Their goals are really orthogonal, and there's no way you can really learn from each other, right? So these are the things that we'll talk in the next half an hour or so, and then we'll have time for the Q&A. My name is Tathagat Varma. I am a independent consultant. I work on basically product development organizations with agility, innovation, leadership, and a bunch of these areas. You can go to my blog, read about it. I'll not fill in with that. So let's get started here. How many of you solve problems here? Can you raise your hand? We all solve problems here. Does anyone would like to share, how do they solve problems? Is there like, what's your typical problem solving pattern? Anyone? Brainstorming. So you come up with the, you basically, brainstorming is used for what purpose, if I can ask you? To come up with ideas, to come up with solutions. Come again? Workshops. So what kind of workshops are these? You're looking at various, you're getting all the people in the room and talking about various, it's a group discussion kind of a thing. So I'm sure that's probably one part of the whole problem solving, which is like, brainstorming is you're coming up with a lot of them. If you could be using the workshop, are there any other things? We need to understand the problem very well, right? If we don't even understand what is the right problem, we are probably going to be solving a wrong problem. And we might be world class in solving the problem, but turns out that nobody wants that solution. And I'll talk about it. One of the big challenges that we see, I spend a lot of time with the startups. And one of the big challenges I see with the startup community, at least in India and in Bangalore, is we have a lot of techie startups. You know what that means? I'm talking about that with a little bit of condescending tone here. The techie startups are, oh, I have this great solution which I can hack together with Hadoop and big data and all that thing. And this is now, I have built a solution. Now that is a solution in search of a problem. Which problem can I go and solve now? Have you seen one of those? Do you work for one of those? Okay, I'm taking that as no. The point is, a lot of times we really think that I'm a great coder, so I can really build that solution there, but I don't even know what is the problem I'm trying to solve here. So I very rightly said, unless we really calibrate what problem we want to solve, our effort might be futile. And we'll see, there is hard numbers to actually tell us how a lot of these startups die because of that kind of a thinking there. Okay, anyone else? Anything else that you do when you solve the problem? 5-why might be a great way to do a root cause analysis. Why is that happening? Why is that happening really? The more popular management style is not a 5-whys, it is 5-whos. Right? And that's why it makes a lot of sense, because most of the time, the leaders and managers are like, who screwed up? Okay, so who really slept on the job? Who did not do their job? So 5-whys, you don't realize the importance of 5-whys until you have been in a very toxic environment where the only questions asked were 5-whos, right? And that's when we, so 5-whys is a great thing. It depersonalizes, it's like taking the people and personality away from it and really focusing on what the problem is, which is the key part of that. Anything else? Anyone else? Come again? Fishbone diagram could be another way to really understand the cause and effect there, fair enough. Mind mapping could be a great way to kind of, especially if it's a very unstructured kind of information we are dealing with, kind of give a visual language to it. So that might be the one. Come again? Trial and error is a great idea actually. There's nothing wrong in that. A lot of times we look at it with a lot of contempt, but a lot of times trial and error might actually be a great way to get started there. We have just been able to refine some of the trial and error approach with some of these ideas that we'll talk about there. Anything that we missed out? User empathy maps, prototyping, right? So a lot of these are all of them are right answers, by the way. And we'll try to understand how we actually put them. So I'm going to talk about these two ways in which we do that. Let's start with the first precursor to that. Now the problem is when we are trying to solve unknown kind of problems, none of them is really laid out on the table as in like tuck, 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 step 1, 2, 3, 4 kind of a thing. Quite often, the problems really resemble what we call as a design squiggle. And a design squiggle essentially means that when we are starting with the uncertainty, the pattern is really very chaotic in nature. It doesn't really follow a very linear pattern of problem solving. So there is no way you can really say that you do a step 1, step 2, step 3, step 4 kind of a thing. Think of it this way. How many of you know how to make a cup of tea here? Pretty much everyone. We kind of know the recipe. Step 1, take water in the kettle, put it on the gas, turn on the gas, da-da-da, like the step 1, 2, 3, it's kind of clear, right? But suppose we are all living in a world where the tea has not been discovered yet. Nobody quite knows how to make a cup of tea. And we have all entered in MasterChef and we are all trying to make our own cup of tea. Would all of us be having the same formula here? We would not probably have it, right? We would all have a different formula for making a cup of tea. And over a period of, as a gentleman in the back said, over a period of trial and error, we would stumble upon what is a better pattern for a cup of tea. But until such time, we will be in the woods here. We quite don't know what really is going to work there. But once it is kind of known how to make a cup of tea, then that recipe is kind of straightforward. Now, I know even with the same recipe, I can guarantee that 90% of us will actually successfully manage to screw up a cup of tea, right? And it depends on that. I might be able, but something goes wrong that day because there's a lot of subjectivity in that. But by and large, the pattern that I'm referring to is the ability to come up with a recipe for making a cup of tea versus an ability to follow the recipe are two dramatically different competencies. This, if I take the same parlance here, this is what a cook will do. A cook will be able to follow, a great cook would be able to follow the recipe extremely well. But this is not a cook's job, this is a chef's job. A chef would not follow a chef would make a recipe. And that is a big difference in the mindset and the competencies needed between us. A lot of times, in fact, the ills of software industry for the last 50 years are that we have taken this, which is like a production method, and we have applied it to software development, which is a design problem. And that's the reason why we have all the problems in software industry. We have not recognized that when we are doing some new creation of an idea or a new creation of a product, we need to solve this problem first before we get to the right side of things there. So we'll talk about these two ways in which how we can manage this uncertainty. How do we really look at this complexity? Let's start with the first one, design thinking. I'm not going to do a primer on design thinking. I'm just going to run over some of the things. I'm assuming most of you are familiar with that. But I'll spend more time in comparing and contrasting design thinking and lean startup. But essentially, if we see, design thinking as a construct has been around for about 40, 50 years. In fact, most people believe that formally as a discipline, it kind of started with a guy of name Rob McKinn in Stanford University in the 70s. He was in mechanical engineering department and they used to build stuff inside the lab. And that's where it kind of started, and there were other people. And then David Kelly was a professor at Stanford in the mechanical engineering. And David Kelly went out and created IDEO and stuff like that. So a lot of work really kind of started because people wanted to develop physical, tangible products. It's an important distinction because when we come to lean startup, we'll be able to compare and contrast what are the big differences we are talking about here. I think design thinking is not just an approach for fixing or solving problems. It is even an approach for finding the problems here. What do I mean by that? Sorry, come again. It's an understanding. We need to be able to understand what is the issue we want to solve. Is that even a right problem we are solving? For all we know, it could be a wrong problem, and we are putting all our dollars and time and energy into that. It's a great construct for poorly bounded problems, things that are not absolutely clear, carved out in stone. How do we do that kind of stuff? Some of you might have heard of this, heard the name of Doug Dietz. Doug Dietz was a product designer at GE Healthcare, and for 20 years of his career at GE Healthcare, he built the CT and the MR scanners. And one of his life-defining moments was when he was standing outside a CT machine, and there was this man who came with a six-year-old daughter, and the daughter had like big tears rolling down her cheek. She was scared to enter that room, and that room was actually the MR scanner. And daddy was telling, hey, honey, we talked about that at home. You got to go there. They need to scan. And this girl was crying. And Doug Dietz, for the life of him, could not understand what was wrong with that, because he was a guy who had been making these machines for a living, and he wanted to believe that we are building machines that are saving lives of people and children. And then he searched more about it, and he found that 90% of the children have to be sedated when they get onto an MR scanner table. Any of you have been on an MR table? I wish none of you have to get, but can you relate to that experience? You are on a cold metallic machine, you are 40 minutes, and imagine a six-year-old child has to do that kind of a thing. They cannot lie down. They have to be sedated, right? So what Doug did this was totally unimaginable. He basically did not, he said, what is the problem we are trying to solve here? And he basically came up with a new series of GE Healthcare machines that are known as Adventure Series. If you just search for them and find it on the net, just look for the images, you would be blown away by what you see that. None of them resembles. They all look like the Disney theme kind of a thing. And if I didn't tell you the background behind it, you would think that this is the latest attraction at the Disney park. That's the way they did that, right? So what problem, this was not a clearly crafted problem. You had to literally, you have to cull out the right problem out of this noise and say, what problem are we trying to solve here? So that's a great example of design thinking in application here. High emphasis on need finding of users. Need finding is an important part in design thinking. We don't go with the arrogance of saying, I know everything about you. We go with the humility of saying, I don't really know anything about you, but I would like to sit down with you and learn more about what kind of problems do you face. I don't go with the attitude of a salesman. A salesman attitude is, I know everything, let me just go and stuff that with the noise and let me sell something to you. We go with the attitude of an anthropologist. We go with the attitude of an ethnographer, somebody who is really interested to say, okay, I just want to have, I'm like a catalyst in a chemical reaction. I don't react with the substance. I just stay there, right? And I'm not going to have, I'm not even a catalyst for that matter, because I'm not accelerating that process. I'm just being a fly on the wall kind of a thing. So need finding becomes a very important thing, because the whole design thinking crux is all about, what problems do people have? How can we solve it? If Doug Dietz did not have the humility to understand why that six-year-old girl was crying, he would never have come up with the solution, and GE Healthcare would never have created a new kind of way of solving that problem. Insights lead to reframing the problem. We believe that learning will only be useful if we are willing to kind of adapt our own position about what problem we are solving. Because learning is a very interesting thing. My definition of learning is, learning happens when the reality does not agree with your expectation. Everything else is just BS. You think that if I leave it, it's going to drop. But what if instead of dropping it, it actually starts floating up in the air? If it drops, is there a learning in that? Probably not, because in the high school, you all have read about gravity. But if I leave it here and it starts floating it up, now that's a learning. As Linus Pauling said, now that we have a contradiction, we have a hope for making progress. Unless we have a contradiction, we cannot make learning. So a learning that only reinforces what you already came in with, what you already know in the beginning of this session, will be useful if I do not really shake up some of your mental models, right? Because you already know them. There's no learning involved in that. So in design thinking, we believe that any of these things are really all about reframing and how do we really solve what problem we are solving here. And prototyping is a means to really expedite the learning process. We are trying to build the prototype, because one of the big things about design thinking is, actually the word design thinking is wrong. It tends to give that softy, gooey, touchy-feely thing that, hey, a lot of people are sitting there in a corner room and they are not answerable to anything. They are just doing a bunch of thinking. Hey, what are you doing? Thinking. What did you do yesterday? We did some more thinking, actually. Right? And what are you going to do tomorrow? We'll do some more thinking. Right? It gives a wrong impression that design thinking is all about thinking. It's actually about bias towards action. That's one of the big mindsets there. So we are really interested in building something. We are really building, we really believe in making something there. And that's what really is prototyping all about. And that gives rise to the learning, because unless we really put something, see, there is a study, there was one of the articles in Scientific American that said we get about 30,000 ideas every day, individually. I mean, that's like literally every few seconds we have an idea, like why this is like this, which should have been purple, this should have been Italian marble, something, there are a bunch of ideas. Most of these ideas die premature, unceremonious death, because we don't act on that. Some of these ideas, we do decide to act on that, and we exchange the ideas, we work on them, we build something there. But guess what? If they remain in your mind, they are useless. Honestly speaking, that is the worst thing to do, because the idea dies with you. But if you build something and you put it out on the table, and as we say, one of the mindset in design thinking is show, don't tell. Just leave it on the table. Just leave it as you're going by and see how people respond to that. Do they look at it with curiosity? Do they look at it with like, wow, this is something I would like to touch and feel, and probably I want to see what is this all about. I want to probably buy that kind of stuff. So that is when you learn from people, oh, is this really speaking for itself? Is it really inviting attention? Is it making people say, I want to pick this item from this aisle and I want to buy this and put it in my shopping cart? That is the kind of learning that you learn from there. And we test the prototypes to validate these hypotheses. So we believe that we don't quite know everything. As I said in the beginning, we are going with the humility of a learner, not an arrogance of a learned. And at that point in time, we say, do we actually understand what we believe we understand? And how do we know that? We are validating some of that stuff there. And iteration is, a lot of times people get it wrong. I think this is a uniform error I have seen in the whole agile community. A lot of people who start journey, they think agile means I'm going to now deliver faster. I think agile is actually a way for you to expedite the feedback more than anything else, because you want to really calibrate where you want to go, and you want to constantly keep realigning whether you are in the right direction. And guess what? Your direction keep, it's a moving target, so you have to keep readjusting that. So design thinking has similar constructs here. So these are some of the stuff, and when we represent it, purely from an experiential, I think Sumit did a great job in the previous session talking about the whole experience part of that. We often represent that as in three circles here in a Venn diagram kind of a thing. Then we say the core thing is really all about people. Design thinking, people are in the center of the equation. We don't want to build it for machines. If we have to build it for machines, we don't need design thinking, because machines can actually talk to each other. There is no uncertainty in communication. There are no vagaries in behavior. They can actually, they work on protocols which are more finite state machines. So you can, when you design for machines, you're not really talking about desirability. I mean, machines don't stop serving you if you're buying from an automated teller machine that they don't like your face or they don't like the shoe that you are wearing, right? It doesn't happen like that. And then technology viability. If it is not viable, we might be building a pie in the sky. It might be a great idea, but then it is like it's like from the future. We don't really quite know how to realize that idea. And end of the day, we want to make money out of it. Unless you want to run it like a Kingfisher Airlines, which I hope none of you want to make money out of it. And there's nothing obscene about making money. The point is, I mean, look at the whole startup community today. 2 years back, there was this all kind of VC money pouring in, and today, in the last 1 year, all the money, VC money is dried up. And the startups have no clue how to really create. So there is a focus on unit economics. Some of you might be following a lot of e-commerce startups there, right? Big bloated profit and loss statement, more towards loss than profit, to be honest, right? And that's a big problem. So in design thinking, what we are looking at is really striking the right balance between the viability, the desirability, feasibility, and the ability part of it. So these are just basically kind of focusing on what is important here. Is there a process to design thinking? There is a slight process. We don't really call it as a process as in, oh, it's an ISO process or a Six Sigma process, but there is a flow. And that flow could be very different in your case than mine, but by and large, it kind of follows this kind of a thinking. We invariably start with empathy. Unless we really understand about people, we don't believe that we should even be solving. We don't even know what problem we are going to solve here, right? Then we go into a define phase. Now, this define actually is a very interesting phase here. And just mark the shape of these bubbles here. There's a purpose why the shape of these bubbles is. If you see, empathy is like you try to go as an ethnographer, like I said, and you go there and really learn about the whole thing. And then you try to kind of squeeze that in and say, what did we really learn out of it? Now, you might have started out with an initial problem statement, which is dramatically different now. It has changed by the time you have come back with the real world, world learnings from there. And then you again blow it up, which is what we call as the divergent thinking. And then you come up with a bunch of these crazy, wild ideas, which could be a brainstorming, it could be a body storming, it could be workshops, what have you, all the ways of basically looking at it. And we know it, that not all the ideas are going to fly. But the reason why we still do that is because if some of you might have read the original book by Alex Osborne, I think he wrote that book in the 50s on brainstorming. He was the father of brainstorming. One of the big things he said, which we have summarily dismissed in the last 70 years of industrial use of brainstorming, is don't reject the ideas prematurely. And guess what? The brainstorming, the way it is actually present in most of the industry, is so corrupted, and it's not a surprise that it doesn't work, right? So in fact, the idea, if you just want to pick up a sound bite, there is something known as brain writing, which has been proven as a better method than brainstorming. And that's what has been found to be more effective. Irrespective of that, you ideate it, and then you come to prototyping. And prototyping is simply a mechanism for you to, I think IDEO calls it as thinking with your hands. I think that's the phrase they use. They say prototyping is thinking with your hands. Most of the time the thinking is staying in the mind, and we don't quite know how to use that or how to get around with something like that. And then finally, we need to test it. That's where rubber meets the road. The idea is useless if it stays in the lab. The idea only is good if it really goes out in the road and fights it out by itself there. So that's like a very high level view, at least a flow of how a design thinking process kind of works there, right? Now let's keep moving and look at lean startup briefly and see how that works there. The lean startup movement kind of started, it evolved from building successful IT startup. Now let me qualify that for a moment. How many startups do you think succeed? Or how many do you think fail? Let's start with that. That's a bigger number. Majority, as in you want to put a number to that? Like most of the people say 90% types, and that's probably an understatement, because most of the startups who probably get funded or who are incorporated, that's a number we are talking about. I'm sure there's probably 2x to 5x of the numbers that are like you and I sitting over a beer and saying, let's do something. And by the time the beer effects are over, the startup is also over. Does that happen to you guys? Right? So now the problem is, and when you look at it, and there are like tons of studies done on why startups fail. And consistently, they have come up with one single metric on that, which is like if you go to the project Startup Genome, which was 2 years back, they did 2,000-3,000 failed startups. They came up with one single reason: premature scaling. And then there was this study, I think, done by Product Hunt, what they did was they took 101 obituaries of the startups. So these were like founders like you and I who, like, they said, okay, I'm done with that. Who else is going to write an obituary of my startup? I will do it myself, right? So they went out and took to blogging, and they wrote it. And these guys saw 101 of those obituaries, and they came up and said 42% of them said there was no market for the product. They were classically exactly what I was telling you earlier. This was a problem, solution in search of a problem. They built some cool, sexy stuff that they could not sell. They could not find the market. Another 20% said they ran out of money. What does it mean, ran out of money? Ran out of money simply means that you had a product that you could not sell, and somebody shut off the tap after that. It's like, guys, now you're on, like, you do anything. I mean, you get to beg, borrow, or steal, but there's no money coming in, right? You've not been able to get it from the customers. So what these guys said, how do we really turn that around? There's a lot of waste in that. Now, waste, again, a lot of people berate the term waste. I have a little different take on that. To me, waste is a pattern that is only visible based on the results of what you have done. By itself, waste is actually a very neutral thing. It's an activity. Now, so unless you have walked the whole 9 yards and gone to the other side of the bridge, and you know whether that activity was successful or not, you are not in a position to even qualify whether what you did was a waste or not. Which essentially means that the pattern of waste can only be culled out after you have walked that path a couple of times, right? So I know that, how do I make a car? I can now make a car there, and I can say, okay, these are the things, like Toyota kind of a thinking, oh, this is taking 2 seconds more, this is taking 5 seconds more, that's a waste. I know it because that pattern leads to a delay in my overall pattern of car making. But if I'm creating Mona Lisa picture for the first time, or I've never done that kind of a thing, or I'm building Twitter for the first time, how do I know what's a waste there? when I'm actually walking on the forward path, not after I'm doing a postmortem, not after I'm doing a retrospective, not after I'm doing a five whys. As I'm walking, can you actually tell me whether I'm actually doing something wrong or not? I bet you cannot, because waste is a pattern that's only visible after you have walked the journey there. So these guys came up with the lean thinking, which they said, hey, we know it, the nature of the beast is, these will fail, that kind of stuff. So why don't we really think in this way that we are quickly validating what you're doing, so that hopefully it's anything that you make a mistake will not get you shot, will not get you fired. It's only one day lost or 2 days lost kind of a thing there. So waste we will still have there, which we will, even in a lean startup world, know only from the results of it. But we will try to minimize it so much so that your runway to the waste is like kind of very small here. It offers a scientific approach to entrepreneurship. When I say scientific approach, if you go back to Francis Bacon, I mean like 1600, the whole scientific method that came out resulting in all the scientific discoveries was essentially a closed loop system. We owe everything that we learned as a human society to basically that closed loop system. We took that in 20th century to what we started calling as the Deming cycle, PDCA, right? Some of you might be familiar with the plan, do, check and act. It was not even Deming who did that. It was Deming's guru Shuhart who basically came up with that. Today we have a new version of that from Eric Ries, which we call as the build, measure, learn loop. Essential thinking is still the same. You take a hypothesis, you find out whether there is data that supports that hypothesis. How do you know that? You do an experimentation with that, and if it works, you reinforce it. If it doesn't work, you change your hypothesis, whatever, at the very fundamental. So it basically, now entrepreneurship was considered as a black magic. You were like that super cool dude who was born with the proverbial silver spoon, who was like, oh, this guy, whatever he or she touches with becomes gold. And there was nobody who was able to deconstruct that you can actually follow a scientific principle to successful entrepreneurship, which is what Eric was able to do. The startup is actually often called as an experiment. If I have to just think on a lighter vein, startup is an experiment done on others' money, right? You don't do it on your money. And so a startup is a grand experiment to know whether there is a opportunity to build a business model like this or not. Now, mind you, startup does not seek to answer, can we build this product? Startup seeks to build, to find the answer for, should we build the product? And that's a big difference between these two, right? And the focus is on learning. So we learn from really doing these experiments. We start with building early minimum viable products. I'm sure that's a vocabulary very common in today's context. We test it frequently using the build, measure, learn loops. We validate learning using actionable metrics, right? So Eric actually makes a differentiation between vanity metrics and actionable metrics. What is vanity metrics? You have no freaking clue why people came and bought your product. Actionable metric, you are able to associate cause and effect. You say, okay, I did this, that's the reason why there was an uptick in the traffic. I did this, that's why we were, like, Apple is a great case in India. 3 years back, Apple didn't sell that well in India, iPhones especially. And they did something which actually led to 4x growth that year itself. Anyone knows what's that? No, this is much before, the 3 years back kind of a story. So they actually came up with EMI. Like we all know India loves EMI, right? We can sell anything on EMI in India. So when Apple came up with that, they did not, so that's a clearly attributable cause and effect, because the product specs are same, operating system is same, apps are same, pricing is same. Apple doesn't change the pricing, but the way they were selling it was, and they were able to do. So that's an actionable metric. It's not a vanity metric, like GOK metric. You know the GOK metric, God only knows, right? I have no clue why this is happening. It's a GOK metric, right? So you build a system of innovation accounting to demonstrate progress. Now in a stable project, the progress can be shown traditionally by number of lines of code, number of lines of document, number of hours, number of pizzas. Have you heard of the pizza metric? It was very common in 90s. Like if you want to know how much hard the team is working, count the number of pizza boxes outside, like that kind of stuff there. So, but what the lean startup practitioner said, hey, when all we are doing are experiments and we are doing like these 200 experiments, how do we demonstrate the progress? Because 90% of these experiments are anyway going to fail there. So they came up with this whole concept of innovation accounting, where you actually create kind of a funnel and say, well, how are your ideas really proceeding in your funnel? Because we still don't know which of them will make money, but we still want to really understand how many experiments you are doing, how many of them are succeeding, and so on and so forth there. And that's a kind of a progress. And fine-tune the model, business model using pivots. right? Pivot was that interesting concept that came into our vocabulary, which was like, hey, we are pivoting. It's like, it's almost like you can visualize, if you close your eyes, you are seeing a pair really dancing, a couple dancing, a ballroom dancing, and they are like pivoting here, right? Another direction there. So pivoting became that interesting construct for the products to do that. And then we said, well, this is the holy grail. You need to establish product market fit. And product market fit became this kind of a fuzzy, nebulous term. But then a lot of people starting from Andreessen and other people have really done a great job in doing. Essence of that is, when you see money consistently coming into your bank account, that's when you have a product market fit. End of the day, that's what. I mean, no more discussion about it. But how do you get to that point? And then you kind of start scaling the business here. So this was the kind of a thing. And what were the big constructs in lean startups? Well, typically it started with a founder's vision. And that was a very common pattern that we saw. A lot of times the IT startups really started from a founder's vision. I have a vision that the world needs a better search engine, right? And you got Google. I have a vision that the world needs a better social networking. Facebook is born. They didn't go out to people. They didn't go out and say a survey monkey, and they didn't go out to say, hey, what do you want? What do you want? They didn't go out interviewing people. They basically said, I have a conviction. I have a deep belief that the world has a place, even though like when for example, MySpace had 200 million people and they were like the king, somebody thought of it and said, I think there is a place for having a better social network. So invariably we see in the lean startup world, the conversations kind of starting from the founder's vision here. This goes on to, then the next thing is about business model. Like I said, a startup is really all about building a new business, which we are saying, should this business be built? It has to have a business model. And this is also a segue into some of you who are familiar with the business model canvas from Alexander Osterwalder. Right, so this is a way, it's a visual language for us to see what are the moving parts of a business, whether you are a $400 billion or you are a two people business, every business you can pretty much represent into those 9 boxes here, right? And then we go on and really build the MVPs. So what we do is we cull out the riskiest assumptions in the business model canvas, and which is what we really would like to validate here with our MVP. Now, an MVP is a very interesting construct, because a lot of times, again, I see people making mistakes and saying, MVP is what will give me my revenue faster. Nothing could be further from truth. An MVP is something that's going to only make your feedback expedited. I think that's an important part of it. Okay, this only shows that I'm using a legal version of the antivirus, which I have no way of, I think I'll need to. All right, so sorry for that. We go to MVP. What do? With the MVP, we subject it to a build, measure, learn loop, which means we are putting that into a very close-ended, tight loop, and we are trying to learn whether our hypothesis is holding up or not. What do after that? That results into validated learning, because now we know for sure, because these are actionable metrics. What does that mean? I am able to attribute cause and effect by doing it. I go to the next one, which is my innovation accounting system. My innovation accounting system takes me to the eventual question of pivot or persevere, which means we have been doing it. Are we getting the results? Should we continue down that path, or there is a need for us to kind of change the way there? And then finally, if we have product market fit, we have the fireworks, right? Because that's when you really can celebrate. We have found out the way to consistently make money. That's what is product market fit all about. We know the markets, we know the pain point, we know how to sell, we know what the channels, we know the pricing structure, we know the revenue stream, we know how much it's going to take for us to do that, key activity, key resource, and now we can sell them. It doesn't need somebody with an extra charisma to kind of go and sell that. It doesn't mean me to call my uncle who will call somebody's father-in-law to get the business. That means personal relations are taken out of the equation. It is the merit of the product and the pain point, and we have understood that fit very well here. And then finally, we get to the point of scaling up. So this is like in few bubbles, I would say this is what is really the whole lean startup kind of a thing there. Because you want to scale up only when you have really accomplished the product market fit. Now, these are the two models. I just wanted to kind of walk through both of them. Let's see what are the similarities here at a very high level. Both seem to have a focus on needs, on the user needs. Now, slight distinction. Design thinking really talks about user. It doesn't really, or human actually, even better term for that. But in lean startup, we would probably talk more about customer. I mean, lean startup itself came from Steve Blank's customer development model. So customer is a construct more from a business kind of a thing there. But nevertheless, they both are really looking at how do we innovate around the needs of people. That is really the key part of that. They both expect uncertainties. We don't expect things will be known to us. We think it will be fuzzy. We'll have to work around it. We'll have to really discover the whole thing there and really keep moving from there. So they both focus, start early and make stuff. None of them is really all about PowerPointing. None of them is really about pontificating on something. Like I said, sat in a corner and saying, we are doing thinking. We are design thinking. They believe in making the stuff there. They both believe in building scrappy prototypes. None of them say we should get $1 million on the table and then we'll build this fancy stuff in stealth mode. In fact, stealth mode is really the antithesis for both of them. They don't want to. They believe lean explicitly is all about removing waste from the system. And it's like instead of really validating something at the end of 18 months and then saying, oh, that was a bad $1 million that we invested, why not try to identify the riskiest hypothesis that we can validate starting tomorrow or next week or next month in fraction of the cost? And if the idea is really bad enough, then let's kill it sooner than later. Why do we want to persist with that, with the bad pain here, right? So they both kind of look at building the scrappy prototypes. Validate from frequent iterations is common in both of them. We are trying to establish the learning point, and learn and proceed is a common theme. We don't want to proceed, or we don't want to invest or commit dollars when we have not really been, we have not validated whether that's the right direction or not. So these are the similarities. Now let's look at some of the dissimilarities. I don't want to call it as dissimilarities. I prefer to use the term strengths. Both have their own strengths, and that's what let's talk about, and another two slides will be done with that. So I hope that's visible from the back, but sorry about it because that's a busy slide. There are about 9 categories that I culled out and did. So let's look at the vision. Design thinking, we are trying to solve a problem. In lean startup, we are trying to build a business. That's a big difference. And because solving a problem could be that it's your neighborhood parking problem and you want to solve that problem, and you might apply or you might employ design thinking as a mechanism, as a means for you to kind of solve that problem. You don't have to build a business around that, right? But lean startup is a more structured approach to really kind of build the business around that. The kind of problems we solve in design thinking, we typically take the category or class of problems known as wicked problems. Now, wicked problems is actually a term that came out in 73 by a UK social scientist who came up with 10 parameters and said social problems don't lend themselves very well to the predictable class of problems. For example, the outcome is not known. I mean, some of you, for example, in India, we actually probably created the world's biggest public health program when we achieved success in the polio program. And took us, what, 50 years to get rid of the last known case of polio, right? That's a social problem because we struggled year after year, just to get rid of it. And a country with 1.2 billion people, how do you make sure all the children under the age of 5 were given the oral vaccination on the same day? Because that is the medical science behind it. If any child is left behind, there's a possibility of transmitting the polio virus through the human excreta. So they had to make sure that it had to be done there. Can you actually sit down in a room like this and a fancy whiteboard and stuff and say, this is how we are going to solve the problem? Not just not going to happen there. So we don't quite know the solution to a wicked problem until we have kind of solved the problem. That's an element of that. Sorry. Thanks. But here we are talking about high-tech products, which is how it kind of the genesis of lean startup was. When Eric used to work at IMVU, that was like one of the examples. And then a lot of examples that we see. So they all came from a lot of high-tech products. Even though today lean startup as a thinking is being applied beyond what started out with. Just like when agile kind of started, we said, hey, this is like a small project or something. Now we are saying, hey, does agile work for my carpentry work also? It's like, does it work in education? People are trying it out, but the genesis of that was similarly here kind of it. The mindset is really about problem discovery and need finding. You cannot be a good design thinker if you are not really having the right level of respect. See, there are two words in English, beautiful words. One is judgment, not so beautiful word, but the second word is discern. And discern is a beautiful word. Because what happens is when we are judging, I'm implicating you actually. I'm saying, hey, that means you are, hey dude, you don't know how to do that. I'm actually judging you from that. But when I'm saying I'm discerning it and saying then I'm actually giving you the right respect as a problem solver. I'm saying, yeah, these are the innate difficulties. I recognize them. I'm not really blaming you and I'm not attributing it to you. So if people do not know how to use XYZ, I'm not blaming them for saying they are low-tech people. I'm saying I respect the fact that these people actually have the problem. How can I solve it now? Right? I mean, it's very easy for me to say, oh, why don't we, like, for example, some of you might have heard of this project, Litter of Light. Litter of Light is a wonderful project. Those who have not heard, just do a Google on that. Basically, they said there are slums in Argentina and Philippines and Mumbai and all over the world which don't get a ray of sunlight ever. And they said there are people who were born in darkness and they have never seen a ray of light in those houses. And they said, how can we solve the problem? And they, people like you and I will say, hey, why don't you give them solar light? Why don't we give them XYZ? We give them cheap light. And somebody came up with that, hey, why don't you take a Pepsi bottle, put some baking soda, put some clear water, hang it on the roof, and you will have 55 watts of electricity available to them. And that's a life changer for those people, right? People in Vietnam have persistently had the problem with anemia. They had low iron, for example. And they said, how do we solve the problem? And traditionally, every civilization in the world has cooked in iron. And they said, hey, iron is, because of the modernization, we are not using iron that much. So how do we solve the problem? They said, let's make a cube of iron or something. So people actually put it in the stew that they are doing. And they, because of the boiling of that, the iron will come there. Sounds an audacious idea. But guess what? Only those audacious ideas have a chance in that world, right? And they eventually came up, and they came up with this concept known as the lucky goldfish. Just search for the lucky goldfish. So they said Cambodia fish is a lucky symbol. People would hate putting a blob of metal there, but if something is shaped like a beautiful fish, they don't mind doing it. So they actually built that solution, and now people in Vietnam, they basically, what they do is when they are doing the cooking and stew anything, they drop that iron fish, easy to clean, easy to maintain, doesn't rust there, and they get all the iron that's needed for their diet by just dipping that inside the food being done there. So you are not really, you don't even know what problem you are solving until you have really gone there, as I said, like an anthropologist who goes without any kind of overbearing or any kind of a judgmental attitude and saying, okay, let's understand what are the design patterns that have evolved and sustained over thousands of years of civilization. Can we build something around that? Maybe there is an opportunity. In a lean startup world, we are really looking more on founder's vision. I am the boss. I am the one who has really got, I have got 72% stake in the company. I am the one who is doing the hard deal with Sequoia. So I call the shots, right? I mean, that kind of a thinking, because I know what problem we want to solve there. Good or bad, that's exactly how we would look at that. Or a product in hand. I have this idea, I want to build this product. I don't even know at this point in time whether the world needs that product or not. I'll give you an example. Amazon, great company, wonderful products there. 2 years back, came up with this idea that we want to build this smartphone, Amazon Fire. Anyone remembers that? Probably the most advanced phone ever made. 4 front cameras. They actually triangulate into a 3D projection and all. They started selling it in May of 2015 for $200. After 1 month, they were selling at $1 and nobody was buying it. Because nobody wanted a $170 million phone. Right? If you read about that thing, it's like even the great companies can screw up like that, right? Because they were focused on building a product which they thought was the right product for them. There was a product in hand. But as a design thinker, I would probably want to start with that. Whom am I solving the problem for? What are the issues there? Do they even need that kind of a thing? For all we care, they don't need a product like that. They need something else there. Am I willing to change my position there, right? Approach. The approach is more qualitative design thinking, where it is more quantitative in lean startup. So we are really focusing on, we are trying to really talk about more of emotions of people. How do they really respond to something? Here, how many clicks happened? How many conversions happened? What is the CTR? When I used to work at Yahoo, one of the big things at Yahoo that we would always look at is what is the click-through rates, or what is the adoption, or the page views, or the time spent. So we are looking at these hard metrics for each of that stuff. How much can I measure? So I do an experiment. I'm saying, okay, my CTR was 1.27%. Does my CTR go up from 1.27 to 1.3%, 1.8%? Then I know that I have statistically made some movement there. So that's a big difference in my view. From a qualitative to quantitative, from intuitive to analytical, that's a big shift in how we look at it. The focus is more human-centered and users. Here it is more engineering-driven. It tends to be more engineering-driven because the examples that we have seen invariably come from tech world there. It doesn't have to be like that. It's just, I'm just positioning it the way it sees. The hypothesis tends to be, here it tends to be more generative and explorative in nature. We really want to see, okay, what are the possibilities? How could we do things differently here? What would happen if we did something like that, right? And here we are really looking at validating and experimenting. Okay, if we did this, what's going to happen here, right? That kind of stuff. The inquiry tends to be more ethnographic, more open-ended. Here it is more problem statements and actionable metrics. There's a big difference between the ethnography versus actionable metric, because in ethnography, we are not even saying whether it's good or bad. All we are saying is, I'm a fly on the wall and I want to really learn about how you do the stuff there, right? You might do what we call as mobile ethnography, which is a new thing, which is like, take my mobile camera with me and keep clicking pictures, right? And that is actually how I'm summarizing how you really respond to the system. There is no metrics, it's just recording the behavior here. So learning is really here, when we learn, the learning is really fed into reframing the problem. Because we have learned it, the insights are available, what do we do with that? Learning by itself is useless if we don't act on that. How we act on that is reframing the problem, and how we act on this in a lean startup world is really pivoting on that. So we are kind of calibrating and we are going in the right direction. Finally, in my view, if I have to summarize everything else together in one single word, I would say the theme of design thinking is empathy. To me, at the end of it, design thinking is simply about empathy. There are n number of ways of solving a problem, but I think the one thing that it really is most distinguishing feature is all about empathy. On the other hand, lean startup came up in the world of IT solutions, and speed became a big enabler there. And I, some of you might have read the blue book, Eric's blue book, right? The lean startup. And one of the things he says, the most successful people or the companies in the future will not be the companies that deliver fastest, but they will be the who learn the fastest. So speed is implicitly and explicitly kind of a big deal in the whole lean startup world there, right? So this is how I kind of summarize this things there. So let's ask the question here, is design thinking versus lean startup, is that the debate we are talking about? Or do you think that the narrative is probably design thinking and lean startup? What do you guys think? Do you think there's an opportunity to kind of have them together? Because if you came with the intention that we are going to have a bashing session there, sorry, you came to the wrong session, right? The idea was not to really bash and say which one of them, right? And again, where does the agile fit into that? Anyone has any thoughts on that? Right? Because one of the big things that actually agile doesn't explicitly talk about in that sense, and it's kind of left us to fend for ourselves, is like, well, let's say, for example, okay, Scrum says you should have product backlog. Who the hell prepares a product backlog? Where does it come? Is it like one fine day you get up in the morning and you have a product backlog? Like, how do you even get to that point, right? So that kind of a thing there. So there are ideas, and if I just take, and I have shamelessly picked this up from a Gartner slide here, I think it's kind of a very interesting thing, because it kind of starts from the design thinking on the left here. And you kind of start from some of these ideas of empathizing, and then from a concrete term, because you are trying to really live in a real world, you get into the abstract world of kind of defining, articulating the problem, ideating on that, and then you again come to the boundary where you get kind of lean startup mode of thinking, where you kind of do the experiments in a build, measure, learn loop, right? So this is the build, measure, learn loop that is happening here, and you are making iterations in that. And then basically, now whatever is the successful outcome of those, I don't want to use the term stories, I don't want to use the term backlog, but whatever is the successful outcome of the patterns of problem, they could be feeding into what eventually becomes your product backlog, right? So when you are basically looking at new to the world, 1.0, like totally new stuff, and you are starting on a clean slate, invariably Scrum will tell you how to start here, but actually if you are really doing something for the first time, you might want to consider How do you even get to that point? How do you, now it's very easy for you to just come up with any orbit list here, but how do you systematically validate them? How do you kind of go through the whole idea of empathy, especially if your products have a very high touch feel kind of thing with the human beings? And then how do you systematically validate it so that there is a clear attributable cause and effect between them, which is what is probably going to lead you to the backlog. I won't call it as a backlog. To me, it's a feeder to the backlog. It's actually something that's helping you converge into the backlog better. Okay, let me recap here. I think in my mind, it's not about or, it's about and. I think both of them have a place. They have complementary role. They might have commonality and overlap of methods, but don't let that fool you, because I think these are serving different kind of needs in the problem solving apparatus that we have here. Design thinking offers great guidance on uncovering human needs and identifying the right problem. I think that's, to me, no doubt in my mind. by donning the hat of a design thinker, like Doug Deeds did for GE Healthcare as an example, you can actually come to the right point of what problem should we be solving here, right? And identifying that there. On the other end, lean startup can actually help you proceed on the journey by providing a framework for systematically validating the solution hypotheses in very fast loops. Because you need to find a way to really say whether, okay, does it look like a pie in the sky, or can I actually, is it going to work there? Do I have data to prove, or is it just my gut feeling there as a founder's vision or a hypothesis there, right? And finally, to me, I think what's going to help you is really an integrated approach. It's not about or, it's not about saying this is better than this. I think the way I look at the toolkit is each one of us should be looking at it, and all these things should be in our toolkit, and saying, okay, this problem, can we apply some of these ideas and really solve it better, rather than saying, oh no, my current method does not allow me to talk to the other method. I mean, if you are caught into that trap of saying, oh, my current method doesn't allow me to talk to other method, you should be throwing away that method, in my view. You should really be embracing the best of it, because you are not paid salary by the people who created the framework. You are paid by salary and lunch by the people who are buying your solution. They don't care, to be honest, what problem or framework do you use. They care about the solution you give, right? So with that, I think I'll stop here. It's been 45 minutes. I don't know how much time I have for the Q&A here. Okay, but thanks a lot for your patient hearing. I hope it was valuable. Thank you. If we have one or two questions, okay. So actually, Eric has, even when he talks about it, he has alluded to the fact that they have learned ideas from design thinking as well. Design thinking just evolved by itself in another world, and lean startup kind of evolved around some of the ideas within the IT-based startups there. They have borrowed, design thinking has been a precursor in that sense, but lean startup has definitely used some ideas on that. So maybe it has some things there. I won't know whether to call it as an umbrella or not, but definitely they have some commonalities there. I think you had said. Right. Right. I would say that at some point in time, you'll have to, if you are a product owner, you will have to determine how do I do my product delivery, and if nobody is giving you a product backlog ready-made, you will have to create your own. These are two good approaches to think of. Some problem might be more human-centric point of view, and they actually help you to start with design thinking. In some of them, maybe you are building a tech product like a Dropbox, for example, where you believe the technological complexity is of a different type. Maybe you want to start with that. But compare and contrast it, I would say. I don't think there is a one-size-fit-all prescription, but definitely some of them would be needed pre-scrum to kind of do that thing. Yeah, you can do that. I think we can probably catch offline. Thank you once again. Thank you.